So the first and most important fundamental fact about money is you don't own it. God does, and he's made you the manager of the money. No, businesses, they have the owner. The owner's the one who puts in the money. He puts in the finances to start the business. But most owners are not the manager. Most owners just put in the money, and then they hire managers to take care of the business, right? So here it is. God put everything into this world. All the wealth that's here, God put it. He invested into this world and put all of its wealth here. But then he's made us to be the manager of that wealth so that now the things that we own, we think we own, we're only the manager of it. So we have to shift our thinking about money. We have to quit looking at ourselves as owners and possessors of things, but we have to look at God, who's the owner of all things, who's made us a manager. The King James uses the word steward. What does the owner want the manager to do for him? He wants him to make money, right? So that means you're supposed to increase and produce. So in reality, God expects you to increase and produce more for God and his sake and his kingdom. So we have to look at prosperity not as something I want to be rich for myself. I want to be rich because God requires me to make more for him. Because the more I make, the more I can give. And the more I can give, the more I can help others. See, this is what it's all about. So we have to have a whole mentality shift from the secular viewpoint of money, which is, from a secular viewpoint, it's the whole idea is, what can you get for yourself? But in God's point is, what can you get for God and how can you bless other people? A whole mind shift has to be, we have to undergo. So now, look here in Luke chapter 16, verse 10. Luke 16, verse 10, Jesus said, "Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much." So if you have, now watch this. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Now, what a powerful teaching. I want us to look, though, carefully at the very context of this teaching. Because when we look at the phrase that's found in verse 10, whoever can be trusted with very little, can y'all say very little? Can be trusted with much. So what happens is sometimes when we think of very little, we forget the context that Jesus is speaking about. To him, the very little is actually money. He's talking about money in the passage. So when he says, if you can be trusted with money, then you could be trusted with much. He doesn't mean much money. He means different things in life. He's saying you have to be trustworthy with money before God will let you be trustworthy with other things that are more important. So what this passage is teaching us is the most least important thing that God ever makes us manager of is our money. The least important thing. And here's what Jesus is teaching. Is if you cannot be trustworthy with the least, then what makes you think you're going to be trustworthy with more important things that God gives you in life? Money's the least important thing. That car you drive, that is the least important thing God ever made you a manager of. I give you something more important. You're probably sitting next to him or her. It's called your spouse. It's called your children. Would you agree your wife is more important than your money? Well, Pastor, she's a money drain. She's just taking all. So what? Let her take it. She's still more important than your money. Your children's more important than your money. Your ministry is more important than your money. Money's the least important thing that you have. And now here's what Jesus is teaching us, though. See, we sometimes read this and we kind of, you know, we miss the context and we miss that he's really talking about money. So we read things like, if you can't be trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? And we kind of say, well, what this is saying is you got to be faithful to serve someone else before God will let you be the boss. And that is true, actually. I mean, we all know that to be true. So that's a general principle. In other words, one way to apply it is, how can you expect to pastor your own church when you don't even want to help someone else be successful at pastoring his own? You know, some people, they just sit in the wings. They're in this grandstand waiting for the opportunity for God to say, go pastor a church. And then you take off and call a few people from our church and say, I'm going to start a church. Would you like to join me? You little thief. But see, we do this. Instead, what we ought to be doing is we should be serving the pastor and saying, how can I prosper this church and how can I bring more people and how can I make this church successful before God will ever give me a chance? Now, that's generally how people interpret this. And that application is good, but that's not what Christ is still teaching. His focus, though, is that someone else's property, it's money. And that's what he's saying is, you cannot be trusted with important things if you cannot be trusted with money. So here it is. Trusting God in your finances is the, quote, very little of trusting. If you can't trust God with your finances, how would you trust God for your healing? How would you trust God for your business? How would you trust God for your marriage? How would you trust God for your children if you can't trust God with your money? See, and so this is the fundamental part of trusting God. All trust begins with trusting God with our money before we trust him with our lives and with our businesses and with our wives and our husbands and our children and other and ministry. We got to trust God with our money. Because now listen, are you ready for this? If you cannot be trustworthy with money, you're not going to be trustworthy with anything else more important. Which means this, are you ready? If you cannot be trustworthy with money, you will not know how to handle a wife. Thank you for that amen. Yeah. You won't be able to handle a wife if you can't handle money. A wife is more important if you can't handle... So now, can I help my sisters? I want you, listen to me, sisters. I love you. I want the best for you. I know you want to get married. But when some guy asks to take you out, before you say yes, just ask him one simple question. Ready? Do you have a job? Well, no, I live with my mama. She takes care of me. He said, no, thank you. It's okay. God bless you. And I have scripture to prove that. I knew you'd have a passage on everything, Pastor. Look, I'll give you a scripture. Genesis 2, you know what God said? The Bible says God made man first and put him in the garden to work it. Then later, he pulled a rib out and made a woman. God said to Adam, you ain't ready for the rib until you work on the tree. But a lot of us want to play with the rib. Hello, you are sexy hourglass rib. You are a pretty rib. And that rib's looking saying, do you have a garden to work? No, I don't have a job. Go get the work in the garden before you play with this rib. It's so simple. And I'm going to tell you, sisters, if that guy is cheap and he makes you pay now, he's going to make you pay through the nose when you get married.